guidance, we have humanitarian interest in protecting people so they're not brutalized by warfare. And we additionally have to recognize that over the last 75 years, from World War II on, we've created the most muscular military force on the planet. And just because of the gravitas of who we are, we're drawn into these matters. So we balance humanitarian needs, our ally relationships. I think we'll, over time, investigate. We've begun by bombing, not committing troops at this point, and time will tell if we need to do more.
Congressman, what is our role, what should it be, as we move forward specifically with ISIS?
Yeah, I think the president has an incoherent foreign policy. He hasn't come to Congress for authorization. I believe he must do that. He hasn't made the case to Congress about what the specific threat is to the United States, in other words, to people in the United States. We've all seen the heinous, horrendous acts of violence that are committed by ISIS overseas. The question is whether we need to engage in a full-scale war. I don't think the president has made that case yet to the American people. He's started to launch a bombing campaign without congressional authorization, yet pledges to not put troops on the ground. But once you start to bomb another country, you can't make the pledge not to put troops on the ground, because anything can happen. So either he should come to Congress, make the case to us, and we can make a decision about whether we want to go into a full-scale war, or he should rethink his strategy, because the strategy right now is going to create more chaos. If it's a situation that is affecting people overseas, people in that region, they need to take the lead.
Continuing in the region with another set of circumstances that are familiar to all of you, starting with you, Congressman, Israel and Hamas achieve occasional moments of relative peace, but the threat of further bloodshed is never very far away. How should the United States be involved in that conflict, if at all?
Well, we need to be diplomatically engaged at all times. The United States is the sole superpower in the world. And so if we're not diplomatically engaged in that region, we're not doing our proper duty as a superpower. That doesn't mean we have to be engaged militarily. We have been supportive of Israel. I've been supportive of the Iron Dome system, which has been protecting the people of Israel. And at the end of the day, peace needs to be achieved by the people of that region. It can't be imposed from the outside. A lot of the problems we have today in the Middle East are the result of the United States and outside powers imposing boundaries, borders on that region. And throughout the Middle East, you see a lot of groups that are hostile to each other who have been put in situations where they're in close quarters. So we need to be diplomatically engaged, but be mindful of the effects of military action.
We saw the conflicts with Israel and Hamas earlier this year as they flared to another breaking point. What should our involvement be, Mr. Goodrich?
Well, it's a tremendous challenge. I recognize that foreign powers have been engaged, but it's really the efforts of oil that's drawn us there. The predicate of all this conflict is religious turmoil. And we have to recognize that Gaza, after Israel left a few years ago, has really become a military camp. They're sending missiles that they're choosing Hamas as the ruling entity in Gaza. And Israel is compelled to defend itself, but the underlying animosity is in excess of 1,000 years. And as the Congressman said, we have to be mindful of the humanitarian interest of people living there and recognize our treaty obligations, but it's a Gordian knot that I don't know how we're going to resolve. It's a 1,000-year-old issue.
I want to go on to one more on this subject, and then we'll move to another. And this one is a little longer in scope. But in my adult lifetime, Iran has always been considered a terrorist threat. Now it's being considered by some to be a nuclear threat, which is very unsettling for many people. Part of our conduit to both the issue in Syria and in Iran has been through Russia. And they have been a part of those negotiations. But with provocative actions by Vladimir Putin and a chilly relationship at best between he and President Obama, the question is, are we well positioned because of our relationship with Russia and their relationship with those two important points in that region? Are we still positioned in a way that we can deal effectively through diplomatic challenges, channels?
Well, Iran has, again, this religious turmoil between the Shiites and the Sunnis and the Alawis, which are part of the Shiite world. We have allies that are predominantly Sunni, and Iran is allied with the government of Syria right now. And there's a complexity of who the rebels are, and it's not a simple matter. At the moment, because of humanitarian circumstances and the crisis, the brutality of what the Islamic State element is doing in their declaration of the caliphate, we're doing a preliminary bombing. But clearly, the president wants to investigate, and a lot of that will be done through our allies as well as our own CIA and our own military observation. It's only begun. We don't have a real clear path what to do.
Do we have the right relationships, as I was speaking about with Russia, dealing with places like Iran and Syria?
No, we've been weakened diplomatically. And part of that reason is that the president has drawn a lot of red lines and he doesn't follow through. Now, in many cases, the red lines you draw maybe weren't the appropriate ones. But once you draw a red line, you send a message to the rest of the world if you don't follow through that you are weak, and other countries are likely to take advantage of you. So the president needs to rethink his entire foreign policy approach here. If he's not interested in following through on his red lines, he shouldn't draw them in the first place. And you see countries like Russia and China taking advantage of that weakness. Russia in parts of the Middle East, and of course in Ukraine, China in parts of the South Pacific. And I think these are real concerns of the United States. We need a foreign policy that is realistic, that is clear, and if we dare to make or draw a red line, then we need to be able to follow through. Otherwise, you don't draw that red line in the first place.
Gentlemen, that is, believe it or not, about a quarter of the way through this conversation. So I'm going to try to move these along a little more quickly by shortening the questions, and you're doing great with your answers. I want to talk about Ebola. We know right now that there has already been a confirmed case in the United States because of the kind of travel we have. Anybody infected with anything can be anywhere within hours, and that's a frightening prospect. So my question, first of all, is what, if anything, should we be doing in terms of tracking, putting in quarantine, stopping flights, or taking other measures to protect a further outbreak of Ebola in the United States, Congressman?
Well, we should have been tracking which flights were coming into the United States from countries that have Ebola outbreaks. And we're finding out now that people were flying into the United States without having any checks on whether they came from a region where there was Ebola, whether they were engaged or interacting with people who might have had Ebola. And the risk is a serious one if it becomes widespread, if it starts to break out in a particular area, it can become a serious threat. In the short run, I don't think there are concerns for ordinary Americans. I don't think in the very short run you're going to have a massive outbreak. But certainly, the way people travel around the world, if countries around the world, including the United States, aren't doing more to manage who is flying into the United States from these countries, then it's going to spread very rapidly. It's going to get into Asia, it's going to get into Europe, and certainly will spread further in the United States.
Should we do more in terms of tracking, quarantining, denying flights, those type of things when it comes to Ebola?
I don't think we should panic right now. There's a judge in Houston who's urging us to follow the signs of Ebola. There are certain conditions in which it's infectious, it's not universal. There should be no need for the entire anxiety that is potentially going to propagate. The government's right, it's not going to be a nationwide problem. One of the tragedies of the Ebola circumstances is there was a defunding of part of the program of the Center for Disease Control to look at Ebola because it was not seen as an American issue. And it still isn't really an American issue. But by focusing on the science of how this disease really affects the victims, and how it's transmitted, that's going to hopefully moderate people's anxiety.
I had another question. In the interest of time, I'm going to move on. It's not because it's not an important subject, but I think you both have suggested you don't think it is an imminent threat here in the United States, so let's move on to something else that also involves healthcare, beginning with you. It is something called the Affordable Care Act. You may have heard of it. The Republican House has voted somewhere in the neighborhood of 50 times to either do away with all or parts of the act. It has been a hot button issue from the moment it was brought up. At the same time, Republicans have voted against it. Democrats have said it is akin to being as important as Social Security. So here's the question. Does the Affordable Care Act, in its current incarnation, understanding it's not fully implemented, live up to the potential that it was sold with? And should we continue down that path?
Well, it's fascinating that the Affordable Care Act is well received, where Obamacare is being demonized. And obviously, the same thing. It's been 100 years that we've been trying to get universal health care. We're the only country in the world that, prior to the Affordable Care Act, practice of medicine and health care was a business. The fact that we have now people that have pre-existing conditions that are covered, we have children up to the age of 26 covered with groups who weren't. We have some 15 million people signed up. We're hoping to cover around 30 million. Still going to leave millions of people in the United States without medical coverage. As far back as President Roosevelt in the State of the Union in 1944 called health an economic bill of rights. It is fantastic that we've got a health care bill involving pre-existing conditions, but most importantly, it's going to deal with the excessive cost of hospitals. It's going to digitize medical records. There's an enormous breadth of what this CARE Act is going to do. And why the Republicans, I'm sure grateful they have health care, are unwilling to see it broadly available to everyone, is really kind of the key to this contention between the Congressman and myself. I'm trying to universalize things. That doesn't seem to be his party's plan.
Affordable Care Act, has it lived up to the potential of this bill, and should we continue down that path?
I know we shouldn't continue down the path, and I voted to repeal it. I don't think it's something that can be handled at the federal level. It's not provided for in the Constitution. These are the kinds of issues, health care, that should be handled at the state level, where states can make decisions that are more attuned to the people who live within those states. What the Affordable Care Act does, or Obamacare, is shifts costs. It simply transfers the costs from some people onto others. And if you are a middle-aged person, or a middle-aged couple with a few kids, your health care costs went up a lot. And that's been consistent from people I hear from throughout the district. There are others who had their costs go down, of course, but it's a shift in costs. So we have a big country. This is something that should be handled locally. The state level, it should be handled by the federal government. And the biggest problem we have right now is our third-party payer system, where people pay for insurance and they don't know how much their health care actually costs. The doctors don't know and the patients don't know. Anytime you have a system like that, costs are going to rise because people are going to overuse it in situations where they don't need it.
I want to continue on this and ask this in a broader sense. I know what you think from your description here and what you think, but what do you think about the argument and the fight over the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare? Has that served the American people well? Because on both sides, I believe, there have been promises, claims, and mis- and disinformation. Has that conversation been helpful or confusing to the American voter?
Well, I think the reason there is so much a conversation and so much debate over the Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare, is that it was passed completely by one party. And anytime you pass a massive piece of legislation in such a partisan fashion, where one party decides they're going to run roughshod over the other party, you're going to have a lot of distrust among the American people. You're going to have people who are not happy about it. And so the framers intended this kind of discussion to take place. They intended legislation to be difficult to pass. The Democrats used some questionable procedural methods to get it passed, and now we have this situation where people are very upset. I think it just goes to show that our framers were wise in making legislation difficult to pass, and that when you want to pass something that affects the American people in such a significant way, you should have bipartisan support for it.
Mr. Goodrich, has the conversation around this been helpful to the American people or not?
It's a regrettable conversation because the Congressman just spoke of it as the mechanics of how it was passed and how he would like to see more healthcare focus on the states. I mean, our first history after the War of Independence, we had a period of time under the Articles of Confederation where we did have state managing their activity, and it was a complete failure. There's such a disparity in the size and wealth of respective states. There has to be some uniformity across the country, or very small and impoverished states couldn't help their citizenry. The key is the consequences of the healthcare. It's not the mechanics of how it was passed. It's what its purpose is and what it's achieving. It's moderating hospital costs, it's bringing people under coverage that didn't previously have it. It's going to shift healthcare from being an employer-provided service. And it's just a marvelous beginning. And we should talk consequence, not mechanics of how it occurred.
I want to just take one more moment. You can focus on anything after you answer this first guess. And that is, we know that in this election cycle, the Affordable Care Act has been talked about a lot. It was talked about even more 2 years ago. Does this remain a political campaign issue going into a presidential election in 2 years and midterms 2 years after that?
Well, if senior citizens who are, you know, very fortunate, they have a steady income and they have health care, if they're frightened into thinking that universalizing health care is going to put them in jeopardy, which it absolutely does not, that could change the election. Because as I said earlier, everybody doesn't vote. Senior citizens vote far more readily than do people under 35. If they're anxious about their health care because they feel adding people on is at their detriment, this is not a sum-zero circumstance. We can add people to no one's detriment, and that's not universally known. And that's what makes it still a political issue. If people are fearful, they'll vote according to those fears.
Again, you may go where after making the guess. Does this remain a political issue 2 years, 4 years down the road?
I think so, because it's such an important part of our daily lives. Healthcare affects all of us, and it's going to be an issue that continues in the future. We're going to have to decide as a country what path we want to take. And if we want to lower costs and provide good quality healthcare, then this is not the correct path. We're going to end up with a system where costs go up, and where there's a two-tier system, where the very rich can have all the great health care they want, and ordinary Americans don't have very good health care. So we need to go back to aligning costs and benefits, something we haven't had in a really long time in this country. Technology has improved. Health care can be better now if we have a system where people know what they're paying for, and we can have a safety net for those who are in really terrible circumstances.
We've been talking about big picture stuff down to more domestic stuff. I want to get hyper-local for a moment, starting with you, Congressman Amash. Your job, whoever is elected in November, is obviously to pay attention to the big stuff. But from my perspective as an observer and as a voter, by the way, I think your first job is to take care of the district, the issues that mean the most to the district. And that's included in all we talked about. But talk to me about the real local things. What are the biggest issues facing this congressional district, those issues that you as an elected official at the federal level have the ability to positively impact?
Well, the economy is the number one issue. And we've been fortunate that in our area, our economy is doing better than in other parts of the state. But that remains the number one issue. When I go to Washington, I go there to represent every person in my district. A lot of times, large corporations come to my office and they want a special break for this or that, and sometimes those items are for things in the district. But I have to look at what every person in the district is interested in. And a lot of times the real beneficiaries of those big items are the people who run those corporations, and not ordinary Americans, not regular people. So on a day-to-day basis, I'm led to make decisions about whether I'm going to support a project or oppose a project based on what everyone in my district thinks, not just what a few people think. So the economy is something that is critical, and we also have a lot of farmers in this district, and there are a lot of immigration concerns. I'm sure we'll get a chance to talk about that in a little bit, but immigration and the inability for people to come here legally is also a big concern.
Indeed, we will. But first, Mr. Goodrich, your view on the most important local issues.
Well, local issues are constituency service. I remember as a young man, Jerry Ford is our congressman, and being in a store downtown, LA Cigar Store, and he'd often come in to get a Sunday paper, and I was often there. And he was always very open, had been his entire career, that became a mantra of his time in Congress, that if you were a citizen in the congressional district, it's had different numbers over the years, but Congressman Ford from my lifetime, and successor El Sawyer and Paul Henry, and the current Bernal's prior to Justin Amash becoming congressman, always were available to serve the public. We can do things on the economy with one vote out of 435. I think the principal responsibility, and I think I could do a better job than has been occurring in the last few years, in dealing with constituency questions. If you've got a question with the Department of Labor, the Department of Commerce, if you want to get a passport, or there's all kinds of activities that people in the greater Grand Rapids area and Kalamunda County area need assistance on, I would be there and willing and really privileged to help.
And I would add, Rick, that we have excellent constituent services. I mean, the fact is that's something that my office here in the Grand Rapids area, and we have a satellite office in Battle Creek, deals with on a day-to-day basis, and we're always there and available to help constituents. As I mentioned earlier, I hold lots of town halls, so constituents are well served in this district. They have my ear, and they can come to me with their concerns, and I'm happy to always take a look at their.
As a matter of clarity, were you suggesting he does not give good constituents?
I've had a few instances of people telling me that he's been less than available, and I can only go by what I've been told.
Okay. Let's move on to something else that happened in the district you both hope to represent after November, and that is something that many people were gleeful about. Over in the far northeast part of the district, there was a sign in front of a gas station that said, unleaded, 276. And people were saying, hurrah. When it gets to 116, I'll say hurrah. Let's talk about energy for a little bit. Right now in our country, we are producing more energy than we have in a long time. And I think there, and just to be clear, we are back here for the first question, is that right? Because we did it, okay. So my question is, even though we're producing that, energy independence still is elusive. We still do not have that in our hands. So my question to the both of you, starting with you, Mr. Goodrich, what should we do in the United States about energy independence? Should we do more exploration? What should we do with our regard to further energy production, fracking? We'll get to alternative energy in a moment, but right now I'm talking about those things that may have to be unearthed together.
We almost can't talk about fossil fuels without considering alternative energy. And we can talk about the storage circumstances of alternative energy that really is driving the matter. But when it comes to fossil fuel, we have to recognize what's happening with climate change and the impact it's having on our planet. There's got to be more scientific investigation as to what climate change is really doing to us. And we've had a reduction in the usage of energy. We've got much more efficient tools than we once had. So part of the reason that we have a little better circumstance now with energy is our consumption is down. And so it's not strictly a matter of just finding more oil and putting carbon dioxide into the air. It's a multiple approach, and I would like a little more sophistication is now been happening in the past.
Congressman Amash, where are we particularly on fossil fuels and what should we be doing?
Well, I don't think we're doing a good enough job. We need to expand exploration. We need to expand the amount of energy that we are able to use in this country. I would say that I'm not in favor of any subsidies. I don't favor oil subsidies. I don't favor subsidies for alternative energy companies. I think that there should be a level playing field, and these various energy sources should compete. We need to cut down the red tape. There's a lot of red tape getting in the way of our exploration. The Keystone XL pipeline has been held up, and that's not the only item that's been held up for a long time. At the same time, we need to be concerned about our environment. I think that anything we do needs to be safe. It needs to be considerate of the environment, and if a company pollutes the environment, they should face the consequences.
Let's talk about alternatives. I don't want to limit it. I think about wind, I think about solar, I think about new generation batteries, and there may be a dozen other possible new clean alternatives. How or what role does government play in spurring that development?
Well, government can get out of the way in many instances. Too often, government is standing in the way of our energy development. And energy development means more prosperity for the American people. And the more prosperous your country is, the better technology you'll have, and the cleaner your environment's going to be. So it's all connected. A wealthy country will have better technology that allows them to have a cleaner environment than a poor country. And that's something I think that is often not considered well enough by people on the other side of the aisle. So I want to have more energy exploration. As I said, we need to do it in a clean way. If someone pollutes the environment, if someone damages people's private property, they should face the consequences for that. And nobody should be allowed to extract energy while harming others.
Alternative energy sources and the government's role.
Well, the government, it's astounding that the contrast between what the government's doing for the public interest and private business, particularly the businesses that can afford lobbies. I'm not talking about the hardware store down the street or the person who plows your snow. Those local businesses aren't representative of the international corporations. And you, for a second, think the lobbyists in Washington, who congressmen like to have handle our energy questions exclusively, think those lobbyists are really asking Congress to vote for the public interest or their own private gain. I'm amazed that the government that is our government that's looking out for our interests clearly has to coordinate what the private enterprise companies, who are all focused on their own avarice and earnings. And that's not an appropriate entity to handle such an important matter of how we live our lives. Because energy isn't just a matter of how we fuel our cars and buses with. It's the oil is the source of our plastic. Much of our clothing, much of what we use in our consumer lives beyond fuel is derivative of oil. And it's clearly a public matter, and not a matter that should be left to private profit.
Let's move on to perhaps another of the top two or three contentious issues that have been talked about during this past year in Washington, that's immigration. I'm going to break this down. You are under no constraints, but I'm going to ask some specific questions because immigration as a big umbrella covers a lot of ground. So I'm going to start with this first. Assuming that we need to revamp our immigration policy, and knowing that it has a lot of components, what, if anything, should we be doing at our borders? Is there something that needs to be changed there? Should they be more closed or more open from your perspective?
Well, I wish the terminology, illegal alien, undocumented worker, what a different perspective we'd have if we recognize them as economic refugees. I'm old enough to remember refugees from World War II when I was a child. Coming to Grand Rapids. And we had a different perspective. We recognized the trauma of their European experience, Asian experience, and they're coming to the United States, really. That is the case of the people on our borders. The children who are now confronting us have the trauma of either carrying drugs and risking their lives, or coming without drugs, hoping to get asylum. And we have a court system in this country that's fabulous. If we use it, we can examine each child's, each immigrant coming to our borders and see if they are entitled to the protection of our country as refugees. If they're not, we can deport them. But just to aggressively deal with people as if they were an enemy, why are we treating refugees as enemies? It's a mistake. And I would like to see a more humane and appropriate. We're all immigrants. Every one of us have family members who can remember our coming to this country. Why are we now so hostile? This has only been true in the last 90 years. Prior to World War I, this was not a contention. Why has it become so hostile and contentious? It's regrettable.
The border issue was, what, if anything, should we be doing with borders? Should we make them more open, less open?
Well, first, my parents are immigrants, and it's an issue that is very important to me because I wouldn't be here if not for my parents making their way to this country. For those who are actually seeking asylum, for those who are actually in danger, of course we should be welcoming and welcome them with open arms. Unfortunately, many people are coming to this country claiming asylum when they're not actually seeking real asylum. So we need to have better border security. We need to have a better legal system. Bob spoke about the legal system. I think there's a lot of shortcomings there determining who is actually coming in for asylum and who is who's just trying to make their way into the country illegally. And we need to deal with visa overstays. Many people come to this country legally, and then they overstay their visa, and that's how they remain in this country without being documented. We need to improve the legal immigration system. And this is an area of dispute, I think, between Republicans and Democrats. I often hear from my Democratic colleagues that they want to provide for citizenship, but they don't talk about improving the legal immigration system so that more people can come here legally. And finally, nobody's going to round people up going house to house to deport people. So we need to have a process for those who are here illegally to become legal. That doesn't mean providing citizenship, but providing an opportunity to stay in this country over a very long period of time.
Well, that's my next question. Since it goes to you, continue that thought, and also, Mr. Goodrich, I'll give you a few extra seconds if you want to respond to part of that, because I realize it's a big issue to try to encapsulate in 60 seconds. But I think this is one of the most sensitive parts of this. All of it are very sensitive. But there are people that live in this country who came here outside of the system, illegal. They have taken jobs. In some cases, they have purchased property. They have had children. They've raised family. They have been here for decades in some cases. In any immigration reform, how do you deal with not just those individuals, but those families?
Yeah, these are heartbreaking circumstances. I've had many people come to my office. I've sat down with families that have been split up because of the situation where someone came here legally or overstayed their visa. Sometimes they have children in this country, but parents in another country, or parents in this country and a child in another country, or a spouse is split off from the other spouse. These are very sad, serious circumstances, and I think we need to address them in as compassionate a way as we can. We should ensure that young people, particularly people who came here before they were 18, before we would consider them legally entitled to make these decisions for their own lives. We need to be considerate of their situation and make sure that they are given especially proper treatment, proper care. We shouldn't have a one-size-fits-all policy when it comes to people who have come to the country illegally. We should make sure that we are respectful of the individual situations, and that's something that I certainly feel I will do as a congressman.
In any immigration reform, how do we deal with that group of people who have been here for a long period of time?
Well, it's an issue that really is like holding a mirror to America. It's, the question is, why do some Americans respond so hostily? What is their motivation? It's really looking at us. I mean, if the operative word is fairness. What the congressman just said is completely appropriate. We've got to have some empathy. There's been some family tragedies. But the question I've always wanted to ask, why is it such a driving matter that knowing that people are refugees in need of help, coming up from, nobody's paying attention to what's occurring in the Canadian border, but they are intensely interested in what's happening in our borders with Mexico. Why do American citizens wish to take weaponry to hold off what they consider an enemy who's coming out of necessity to our country? We really have to ask, who are we that we're doing that? As opposed to why are people coming?
Well, I would respond, Rick, by saying not all are coming as true refugees. So there's a difference. If someone is coming here actually seeking asylum, that's different than someone who's coming here for a number of other reasons. So we need to be considerate of the situation, but we also need to be aware that some people are coming here without the proper credentials, without the proper processing that we as Americans expect. I have to represent Americans in this country, and I need to be ensuring that people who come to this country are respectful of our laws.
Do you accept the premise that not everyone does?
I think it's greatly exaggerated. The people with weaponry that are American citizens trying to guard our borders, they're assuming not with the sophistication of a congressman that some may be. What if it's 2%? What if it's a minimal part of the population that's seeking to come here inappropriately? We have to assume, as has been the history of our country for since its creation 400 years ago, the vast majority of people coming here are coming because the opportunities here are greater than they are where they came from, and yet American citizens, our fellow neighbors, wish to drive the people out.
I don't want to spend too much longer on this, but I just want to get this in. You don't have to use the whole 60 seconds, and understanding there are a lot of other issues, but because of the agricultural nature of Michigan, particularly specialty crops that require a lot of what is very often migrant labor that goes around, in any type of an immigration agreement that could be reached, would you, starting with you, sir, would you be in favor of some kind of a guest worker program?
There has been one. It's been somewhat muted, but its continuance obviously would be of great importance to the fruit and vegetable farmers of all of Michigan. Of course, I would like to support the agriculture. It's the second biggest industry in our state, other than auto. Clearly, I want to be helpful.
Guest worker program?
Yes. The program we have hasn't been very effective, and you can just ask farmers about that, and you'll hear from them extensively about how weak the program is, how it doesn't allow them to get the workers they need in time. The issue you have is we have a president who is not very trustworthy on many of these issues. We had Obamacare where he decided that he didn't want to enforce certain parts of the law, and there are Republicans who are concerned that with an immigration reform where you have border security and an improved legal immigration system, and then some type of legal status for illegal immigrants, that the president will not enforce the other parts of the law, will not improve our legal immigration system or secure the border properly, but will work to provide legal status and perhaps citizenship to people who come here illegally.
Gentlemen, I've got at least three more subjects I want to go through. We've got about 15 minutes, so I'm going to try to keep these quick. Spending, budget, and priorities in Washington. There are those who will decry how much debt Washington creates. There are others that will say Washington isn't doing what it needs for the populace in general. Where is the balance, and how do you find that balance when you have at least two sides that are very widely split on the spending or not spending question?
The balance is in the Constitution. The Constitution lays out certain items that are handled by the federal government and other items that are handled by state and local governments. Unfortunately, the federal government is handling more items than it's constitutionally permitted to handle. And so we have a nearly $18 trillion debt. When you look at the budget, the four largest areas of the budget are Social Security, military spending, Medicare, and Medicaid. If you don't address spending in those areas, then you're not going to get the budget under control. So I think it's imperative that Republicans and Democrats actually come together on these issues, forge a bipartisan compromise that actually reduces spending instead of increasing spending, protects people who are receiving benefits like Social Security and Medicare, who are currently receiving benefits or about to receive benefits, while also reforming the programs in a significant way so that the younger generation doesn't have this debt issue when they get older. And I've been on the case of Republicans on the issue of military spending. If Republicans want Democrats to come along on other issues, then they're going to have to look at military spending and be reasonable about the kind of spending we make.
Spending in Washington, the angst that some people feel about it on both sides of the aisle, how do you address that?
Well, I don't know if it's universal on both sides of the aisle. Again, I look to the reality of Washington and not the Constitution. It's a great document that's got us started. We've embellished it and made it work in our 230-year history with it. But the lobbyists, again, in Washington are not advocating for our interests. They're asking for tax cuts to further the profits of wealthy corporations and individuals. And there are a lot of needs of the American public that because corporate America used to be the source of about 25% of our federal funding, it's less than 10 or 12%. And I have to make a correction to the Congressman, our deficit has come down under our current president. There's been a moderation of the deficit. But the deficit could readily be, with the right taxation, we have no stock transaction tax, as almost every major country in the world has. Our deficit is a smokescreen for wealthy corporations through their lobbyists to continue to get favors, which I applaud the Congressman for not being a participant of, but he's not changing the reality of Washington by talking about the Constitution. We've got to change the influence of lobbyists, and that requires a new Congress.
If we can do this without any reaction, please.
The deficit and debt are different items. The deficit, although it has gone down and it will continue to go up over the next few years, actually, if you look at the budget. Every time you have a deficit, it increases the debt. So you can have a deficit that fluctuates from year to year, goes up and goes down, but a deficit means your debt is going up. So that has increased. And when it comes to the lobbyists in Washington, most of them are not asking for tax breaks. They're asking for more spending. So while, yes, they do ask for tax breaks, you more often hear from them for more spending. And they're coming to my office and saying, we want you to spend more on this. Whenever there's a budget impasse, their advice is always to spend more. They tell Republicans spend more, Democrats spend more, and that's how they forge what they call a compromise, which is really just a phony deal.
And just to go back to something you said, when we were talking about the angst on both sides of the aisles, my suggestion was, and I want to give you a few seconds to respond here, my suggestion was that on one side there are folks that say the debt is burdensome and a big problem, but there are people on the other side, as I think you expressed, that say that the federal government could and should be doing more, and that was my expression.
Because they can afford to do so, and we've got to look at what is fair. Is every American living the right life? Do they have the health care, the homes, the food and security that they and their family members are entitled to? And to create a falsity that our government is impoverished, it is a lack of willingness to fund an appropriate life for all of us. And that's why the government is there, and that's why private business, in many respects, is not the panacea the congressman suggested it is.
All right, let's go on to something that government, we believe, is doing. We have heard over the course of the past 14 months that the government, through a number of different sources, has been collecting data of some sorts, be it phone calls, be it phone records, or emails, or email addresses, or megadata, or a bunch of other things that many of us might not even understand. We think, is that a coincidence that my phone just rang? We think that the government may well be collecting and storing a whole lot of personal information about us. What is the appropriate role for government when it comes to collecting our personal information?
The appropriate thing is for the government to follow the Constitution. We have a Fourth Amendment in place, and we have other parts of the Constitution that already provide a balance. They already provide a balance between our privacy and our security, and we should follow that balance. Right now, the government is vastly overreaching. It's collecting data on everyone. And I've been leading the charge in Congress against this data collection. I've been the leading opponent against what the NSA is doing, what other agencies are doing in government. They are sometimes taking our data and then, according to reports, sharing it with other agencies. So they might share the information with the DEA or with the IRS. And these are dangerous violations of our civil liberties. We have a system in place to protect the rights of Americans, and it should be followed. And in many cases, people are being prosecuted through reverse construction of some of these cases. They get the data illegally through the NSA, and then they are reconstructing it. I offered an amendment to stop the NSA from gathering our data, and it came very close to passing, despite opposition from the president, from leaders on the Democratic side, and leaders on the Republican side. We only failed by a few votes. If seven people had switched, we would have stopped the NSA from collecting this information.
What about this data collection, Mr. Goodrich?
Well, data collection is largely being done not only by the government, but Amazon and Google almost have the same server capacity the federal government has. And big data, if it's intrusively looking at our phone calls and is almost accusing us of improper conduct by using certain keywords and then pursuing it. But big data also can help hospitals as they try to examine the environment and the potential for disease. I mean, it's a more complicated matter. The big data is part of our future. I had the privilege of attending a program called Singularity University in December, and big data was a key part of the conversation. As Congressman says, as NSA abuses it and looks at our phone calls, that's wrong. But as hospitals and medical centers look at the big data, hopefully they're going to be able to see information that's going to be positive for us. So it's not all bad, it's not all good. Like most things in life, which I think the Democratic Party is more attuned to dealing with, there's a complexity to it that requires a scientific examination.
With a little luck, we're going to get two more questions. So here is the next to the last. Taking a look at the way Washington functions, or some would say does not function, what do we as an electorate do, and either of you as an elected official, if you prevail in November, would do, to bring back a broader sense, I want to use the word compromise, just discussion. I mean, we've just spent the better part of an hour with two folks who have some pretty divergent ideas in what I think has been a useful dialogue. How do we take this model to Washington?
Well, to really look at everyone's circumstance, however this election turns out, the prevailing person, this congressman myself, will probably receive about 30% of the potential vote. 43% of that potential will stay home and not vote. I'm looking in Congress to address all American circumstances and not be focused on the political struggle of who wins what office. I mean, I worry that Congress as a entity is not looking at the present circumstance. When we lost unemployment insurance, 6 million people lost income. There are innumerable circumstances. We have a couple million people in this country, their sole income is SNAP cards, used to be called food stamps. Those issues aren't being addressed. And I believe that the congressman could be more assertive if he chose to be in addressing current problems. And then again, as I said earlier, looking at the future, you're not going to learn about America's future from looking at its past. The digital changes that are occurring now are far different than the horse and buggy. Who has a typewriter? The world is not what it was.
How do we change that dialogue?
You have to have people in Congress with different attitudes. And more members of Congress have a better attitude about how they look at the other party and how they look at the issues. Unfortunately, there are too many people in Washington still who have been there for a long time, and they have become more and more partisan over the years. And I see it in the House, and you certainly see it in the Senate as well, where one party tries to control the whole process, where the bills are primarily messaging bills instead of actual legislation that is forged as a compromise between the two sides or is given a thorough consideration. It doesn't mean that every piece of legislation is going to have massive support from both sides of the aisle, but it does mean that you should have thorough debate and thorough consideration of each issue. You don't have that right now. When people go to the House floor to speak, they're often speaking to an empty chamber. They're speaking to people at home, and the rhetoric has become so partisan that you can't possibly forge any sort of compromise. That's why people like me upset the political establishment in Washington on both sides. I've formed good compromises with the other side. I've formed good relationships with people on the other side. We've worked together, Republicans and Democrats, this new coalition, to push legislation and to push back against bad legislation. To the chagrin of many in Washington.
In deference to time, I'll drop my final question so we can move on to the closing remarks. Gentlemen, you've been very patient and answered all my questions. I appreciate that. By the flip of the coin, Congressman Amash, you go first with your 60-second closing statement.
Well, I want to just thank everyone here again for participating in today's debate, for being here. I want to thank Mr. Goodrich for being here as well. I think it's fantastic that we have an opportunity like this to have a debate with real issues where we can talk about our principles instead of one of these attack campaigns. So that's something I want to thank you for. I go to Washington every day to represent regular Americans. I'm asking for your vote again. I'm asking you to send me back there to continue to represent ordinary people, not the special interests in Washington, D.C. I'll continue to be transparent. I'll continue to explain every vote I take. It's a lot of work, but I think it's worthwhile. And I think the community is better educated because of vote explanations, because of understanding the process than people in many other communities. I think that's a fantastic thing to get people engaged. We need to keep getting young people engaged in the political process, and that's something that I've sought to do. So I want to thank you for your support, and thank you.
Mr. Goodrich.
I acknowledge, of course, the Congressman's appreciation for your attendance. Also often, politics is just a matter of media, and it's really a privilege to have an actual live audience. I would like to just repeat what I said earlier. I think the operative word that has to be remembered is fairness, and is the congressman looking at the consequences of his votes? I recognize there's a sophistication in how he is often at variance with his fellow Republicans, but again, I don't know if that variance is just procedural or consequential. People's lives are not what they could be if Congress was more attentive to the people and not to the lobbies. Probably no one in this room can afford to have a lobbyist in Washington, and that is the problem. You know the major oil companies, the major pharmaceutical companies, and particularly military industrial complex companies, the Boeings, the General Dynamics of the nation, they have lobbyists. If I'm in Washington, as the congressman was saying, I won't be listening to them, but I will try more assertively to help ordinary people's lives as opposed to just be hostile to big business. There's consequences, the key to this, and I think I can do a better job and look for your support.
Mr. Goodrich and Congressman Amash, I want to take just one final moment to congratulate you both for being here today, for independently on your own working out the details of this agreement to come in and have a valuable conversation. I appreciate you both inviting me to be a part of it. I thank you for what was a well-spent hour, and I wish you both the very best of luck. Thank you very much.
Oh, yeah. Shoppers.